Welcome, everyone. My name is Tina Sørstedt, and I'm a proud member of the League of Women Voters, Dakota County. It is my honor to present tonight's moderator, Lynn Lewis. Lynn is an active and valuable member of our league. She's a trained moderator and currently serving as a co-president of the league and also a co-chair of the Voter Service Committee. Thank you, Lynn.
Thank you, Tina. Good evening, and welcome to the ISD 192 School Board Candidate Forum, hosted by the League of Women Voters, Dakota County. We extend our heartfelt thanks to the candidates for joining us tonight. And a special thanks to the City of Farmington for providing the venue, and to the Apple Valley Rosemont Farmington Communications Department for recording and broadcasting the event to residents across the district. We'll also share the recording on the League's social media platforms and will provide it to the school district. The League of Women Voters, a nonpartisan organization with a 114-year history, is committed to empowering voters through education, engagement, and civic participation. We do not support or oppose any political party or candidate. League of Women Voters Dakota County aims to deliver unbiased information to Minnesota voters, irrespective of their political affiliations. This forum is a public service designed to offer you a chance to hear directly from the candidates about important issues. Please note that the views expressed are those of the candidates and not those of the League. Our sponsorship of this forum does not constitute an endorsement of any candidate. We provide complete, unedited recordings of our forums. Editing is permitted only for official media purposes, and any excerpts or edited clips must not be used for partisan or political purposes. There are five candidates tonight running for three open seats on the ISD 192 school board. All candidates have joined us tonight. We'll begin with candidates' opening statements, each lasting 2 minutes. They'll be delivered in alphabetical order. Closing statements will be given in reverse alphabetical order. Questions will be asked in random order, and candidates will have 90 seconds to answer each question. We kindly ask that you adhere to these time limits. Our timekeeper will hold up a yellow sign to indicate that you have 15 seconds remaining and a stop sign when it's time to wrap up your response so we can proceed to the next candidate. Many of tonight's questions were submitted via email and reviewed by a league committee for clarity. Additional questions were developed based on community interests. Due to time constraints, we won't be able to address every question submitted. Thank you for your participation, and we look forward to an engaging and informative discussion. The forum will conclude in about an hour and a half. So let's begin with opening statements. The order for opening statements will be Kyle Christensen, followed by Joseph Hart, Kelsey Drzyski, Hannah Johnson, and Stephen Cheddar. So can we start now with Kyle?
You bet. Thank you. Thanks for being here tonight. I'd like to thank the Dakota County League of Women Voters for hosting this forum tonight. My name is Kyle Christensen. My wife Lisa works in the district, and my three kids have attended Farmington School since kindergarten. My day job is as marketer for a healthcare services company here in Minnesota. My work is highly collaborative across job functions and with people of many backgrounds and across the country. I thrive on helping to solve problems and to look at data as well as the experiences of others to find answers. I'm a veteran who served 9 years in the Minnesota National Guard. I believe better communities are built through service and cooperation. In our community, I volunteered countless hours coaching youth sports, leading scout groups, and helping with school and parent-teacher projects over the years. I also find ways to put my professional experience to work for others, volunteering for special projects recently, such as an initiative to help small minority-owned businesses in North Minneapolis grow by accessing investment capital, and another to help an organization that focuses on supporting healthier families in underserved communities. I was first elected to this board in 2020. I served as treasurer my first year, was elected as board chair in 2022 and 2023. I'm currently board clerk. It's been a true honor to serve this community. I've learned a lot about public education, about leading through change, and also about compromise and building consensus. With a focus on respect, relationships, and transparency, we've all navigated some of the challenges of the pandemic. We've enhanced how district measures and reports outcomes. We've worked to reduce distractions and ensure more equitable benefits for all employees across the district. Beyond the district, I've poured considerable energy into advocating with the state legislature for special education funding, for school safety, and for other priorities that don't just support ISD 192, but school districts across Minnesota. None of that would be possible without the relationships that with fellow board members. I'd like to particularly thank Hannah Johnson, who served with me as vice chair those 2 years. I'm seeking another term to continue our momentum around academic achievement and to continue our work helping students, families, and teachers feel heard, supported, and connected. Thank you very much.
Joseph?
Good evening, everybody. First off, I wanted to thank the League of Women Voters for hosting this discussion forum. And secondly, to thank everybody who took time out of their busy day to come here and to sit. My name is Joseph Hart. I've been a citizen of Farmington since 2006. I have two kids in the ISD 192 district. One is at high school level and the other one is at elementary level. I've watched the small city grow and go through a lot of growth the last 18 years. I'm aware of the changes that are necessary to help our community and school district best support our students. I would love to help and create a structured, kind, and disciplined, and safe educational environment. I will always be willing to listen to community concerns and feedback from faculty and staff or students. Thank you so much.
Kelsey.
Thank you. Good evening. My name is Kelsey Jazerski, and I am hoping to earn your vote to become a district school board member. First, I would like to express my appreciation and gratitude to the League of Women Voters, Dakota County, for hosting this forum so constituents can become more informed on each of our platforms and where we stand on important topics. And I also want to extend a thank you to everybody who is watching this after this concludes. I hope you find this informative. And I also want to recognize the importance of today and the impact that it had on our country. My husband Eric and I moved to Farmington a little over 11 years ago. We were looking forward to establishing roots and stability for our then six-year-old daughter. Her dad's career as an active duty soldier in the U.S. Army had us moving every few years to new states and new duty stations, but we wanted a home. And that's what we found here in Farmington. Our daughter just started, I'm coming to the present now, but our daughter just started her senior year in the PSEU program at the University of Minnesota. This is her second year doing it. Just last week, our newest addition started his academic journey over at Aiken Road in kindergarten. So we would have one entering school and one exiting this year. It's an interesting dynamic. Our five-year-old was excited to be going to the same elementary school that his sissy, big sissy, did. Though I really think he was most excited about riding the big boy bus. I am just hoping that my answers to these different questions can help everybody understand what I'm passionate about and what I hope to bring to this position if elected.
Thank you. Hannah?
Good evening, and thank you to the League of Women Voters of Dakota County for hosting us this evening. My name is Hannah Johnson, formerly Hannah Simmons, and I'm the current board chair of Farmington Public Schools Board of Education. I've proudly served in this role with Kyle Christensen since 2021, was the first year that I was elected. I have three boys in Farmington schools. They are 9, 7, and 4, and keep me very busy. And I have lived in Farmington since 2014. I have been a part of many things in the community and am passionate about continuing the work that I've started the last few years on the board. Among the things that we've worked really hard to establish over the last few years include initiating monthly listening sessions to expand community perspectives, improving benefit equity and among employee groups and advocating for pay raises that reflect the tremendous value of our educators and staff, adopting a goals and standards-based evaluation model for the superintendent, and identifying measurable goals and indicators of success for the district. We have a lot of momentum going for these issues, and I'd love to keep working on them while continuing to listen to the concerns and questions of parents and families and taxpayers in the community. One of the things that I pride myself on is being a really strong advocate and proactive listener for the things that are important to the people in our community, including our taxpayers, our staff, our learners, and our families. Like many parents, I'm struggling to balance the many things that we all have on our plates, including our jobs, our kids' needs, and just getting by day to day. It's with this advocacy mindset and also the mindset of unity and civil respect for each other that I bring to the board and that I'm most proud of continuing that in the next term if elected. Thank you.
Stephen?
Hello, my name is Stephen Cheddar, and thank you again to the League of Women Voters for the invitation. I appreciate being here. A little bit about me. So I'm a resident of Farmington, been here for 16 years. I'm a husband and a dad to four kids, two of which are previous graduates of Farmington High School. One is in medical school and one is in business school. The two younger kids are both one middle schooler and one high schooler. I'm also a volunteer as a confirmation guide at our local Farmington Lutheran Church. I also volunteer as a ski patrol at a local ski resort. And previously I volunteered for a lot of the kids' sports activities, soccer, baseball, flag football, track. Some of the things I'm passionate about as a prospective board member would be running to support student success, giving them the opportunities to be successful in whatever field or vision they have. And then to encourage parent involvement, to engage parents as much as possible, and make sure that they're front and center in their kids' education process. And then thirdly, to have responsible and a safe operation of our district, to give those the staff, the students, teachers, everyone who's associated with the district, those a great place to be and a welcoming day for their for whatever might come that in front of them. Thank you again, and look forward to the evening.
Thank you, candidates. Now we'll move on to questions. The response order for the first question will be Kelsey Zajerski, followed by Hannah Johnson, Joseph Hart, Stephen Cheddar, and Kyle Christensen. So our first question is, please tell us two or three things you think this school district is doing well. Kelsey?
Sure. I really appreciate the district's clear mission statement. I appreciate how it celebrates both the individual and the educational community. It recognizes how each learner is on their own unique academic journey and that education is not a one-size-fits-all. It also emphasizes the importance of community and a sense of belonging. I also appreciate their innovative and forward-thinking framework, understanding that not all learners share the same strengths, and therefore assessing for achievement needs, or therefore assessing for achievement or level of achievement through different means. They look at, how do I explain this? So the strategic framework looks at everything that impacts a learner, the educators, and the administration that lead it. And it addresses the areas that are most needed in order to ensure a quality education. That is what I think the district's strengths are. Thanks.
Hannah?
Great. Thank you. Two or three things that I think the school district is doing well. The first is fiscal responsibility and accountability to our taxpayers. Our district is consistently recognized for excellence in reporting and accounting by the state of Minnesota and consistently communicates in an effective and easy to understand way school financing. This was one of the biggest learning curves I had when coming on to the board and one of the biggest areas that I hear the most about as a board member. Questions about school financing, what are we doing, what does this mean, why can these dollars only be spent here? And our district works really hard to both communicate that well as run really lean. We have had to make dramatic reductions to balance our budget, and we are running on far less in terms of administrative support areas than surrounding districts in similar size. So that's the first area. The second area is personalized whole person learning for our students. As Kelsey mentioned, our strategic framework is really focused not just on any one aspect of education, but on something called a profile of a lifelong learner, which are three objectives that really are different in the way that we think about educating kids and setting them up for success beyond our district. The final area that I think that we're doing well is community engagement. It's something that I'm really passionate about. Kyle is too. We came on, we served on the community engagement committee our first year and worked really hard and quickly to implement and expand our community engagement strategies to hear more perspectives and invite more opinions to help inform board decision making. Thank you.
Joseph.
First off, I would like to say the strength of a district is the some of the departments that they have. First off, like the fine arts department, the band department is very, very well led. Also the choir, the theater departments, just the fine arts in general. Being a choir kid myself, going through middle school and high school, there's a lot of things that, the basics won't teach. As far as working together to do something, out of the box or what have you. Number two, I'd like to thank the teachers and staff. I thank every school that I go into. These educators are smiling, they're happy, they want to teach these kids, and it's just great to see. It's great to see teachers that care so much, because you can go to other districts, or even thinking back in the past, watching some teachers teach, you can tell like they don't want to be there. I have never seen that, so that is something that is pretty cool. Third, I'm really encouraged also by the Tiger Sports and watching how the kids come together as a team. Whether they lose, whether they win a game, they're working together as a team. They want to see the end goal, right? So at the end of this, even though all my things were kind of more in line with sports and fine arts, there is still room for education in that, but sometimes it just needs to be a little limited, but that's all right. Thank you.
Stephen?
All right. So a couple areas of focus I'd like to make would be, I'm going to relate it to the different levels of the schools. So from personal experience, my kids were probably the most excited I think they'd ever been in elementary school when it was Grandparents' Day. That's probably one of the best days of the whole elementary school experience for them. And most of them were pretty engaged in science. They really liked doing the science fair. They appreciated getting a chance to explore something beyond the classroom that was challenging to them and with their personal interests. And then in middle school, all of my kids seemed to really be engaged with the U.S. and Minnesota history portion of their learning, which occurs primarily in the kind of the middle portion of middle school. And then as high schoolers, they really liked having a lot of variety and choices, getting a chance to try something new that was maybe something they hadn't considered earlier on in their childhood. And also they were generally sports kids. So getting a chance to try a high school sport, either the team sports or some of the individual sports, they all relished those opportunities.
Kyle?
Sure. The downside of being last is I'm probably going to repeat a few things. But no, I think our school district has lots of strength. It's actually sometimes difficult to narrow it down to two or three. But if I do, I mean, there's a couple things. I'll reiterate what Hannah said. I think that the district has worked very diligently to be very responsible with the taxpayer dollars that we get from the state and our property taxpayers here locally. I think one example of that is how much the administrative staff works to align and optimize specific resources and dollars being spent to achieve more than just the initial goal. I'll talk about we accepted achievement and integration funds last year. I think that brought in over $1 million in new revenue to help close achievement gaps. And the administration, they're hardwired to do it. And they really aligned those activities to drive performance and improvements in literacy and participation in advanced academic programs for minority and underserved youth. I think the district as a whole, the teachers in particular, I agree with Joe here. I mean, they're very passionate. They're very passionate about helping students achieve their full potential. And beyond just the specific thing that they're passionate about, but really understand how the learning connects to everyday skills and their involvement in the community. And then finally, kind of supporting all of that, I mean, just the wide range of opportunities that students have to explore their interests. I mean, Joe mentioned the band and the choir programs, robotics, there's broadcasting, performance arts, athletics and activities, and all of this stuff is very well connected and helps to form a really strong community. Thank you.
Thank you, candidates. The response order for our next question will be Hannah Johnson, Kelsey Jazerski, Stephen Cheddar, Kyle Christensen, and Joseph Hart. And our next question is, what are a school board member's roles and responsibilities? How does this differ from the roles and responsibilities of the superintendent or administration? Hannah?
Thank you for the question. This is one of the questions we get most frequently as board members. The primary responsibility of a school board member and the board as a whole is governance of the district. This includes three primary responsibilities: development of the budget, development of policies, and evaluation of the superintendent. It is different and very distinct from the things that we delegate to the superintendent, which is the day-to-day management of our district and our schools. Those things are operations, how dollars should be spent, how curriculum is designed and implemented in our schools, how we respond to questions and concerns from parents. These are things that, as a board, we work really collaboratively with our superintendent and administrative team, and our community relies on us to have a strong, trusting partnership so that we can effectively develop a budget, develop policies, hire a superintendent that supports the vision and goals and that reflect those of our community, our families, and our learners. I will pause there. Thanks.
Stephen?
The primary roles for the school board members, as Hannah mentioned, are again policy. So to present those policies to the district, so to give them some boundaries and some guidelines by which the school will function and operate. Also the role of just guiding and working with the superintendent as a team member and also as a collaborative partnership with school functions and how the school operates. And then thirdly, and perhaps the biggest role, and perhaps the one that can be most contentious, would be the budget and focusing on where those dollars go, how they're spent, and help allocate those things in an appropriate and responsible way. Thank you.
Kelsey?
I mean, even in the middle, it's hard to add anything to what Hannah just threw at us. But I think to add to that, I see our role as a school board, it's a team effort, right? Like, you got people from all different walks of life, different perspectives, different beliefs, and all of that is going to impact the policies that are being created, updated, amended for the learners and for the educators and staff and administrators. Having one person do that wouldn't be fair or equitable. And I think the school board has to have faith in our superintendent. I mean, as Hannah said, he's the one running the show. Berg is the big guy at top, right? And so if we don't have faith and confidence in our superintendent, but also look to him for guidance and collaborate with him, it's not going to be a working relationship. And the learners and people in the district are going to suffer for that. Yeah, it's collaboration, creating relationships, trust, and building upon that. The end.
Kyle?
Sure. 100%. Hannah covered all of the bases. But, you know, that is, there's the macro level. There's that governance versus management construct. We're responsible for overseeing how things work or provide direction for the vision. Actually getting it done and doing the day-to-day work is up to the administration and the staff to make those kind of day-to-day decisions. Where I've seen my own personal growth is really kind of making sure to understand that dichotomy. It's very important. Finance is critical. Jason Berg will say this all the time. If you wanted to find a dysfunctional way to finance something, you'd look to public education. The revenue streams, the way things are expended, the rules and rules around how dollars need to be spent are intricate and complicated. Five part-time, mostly volunteer members can't dive into that, but it is actually our job to ask questions, to be curious, to learn. And I've also seen some of my greatest successes and my most rewarding experiences over these past 4 years doing exactly that, challenging assumptions. And providing advice, we all bring different skills. Every board member brings different skills and background to the role. Leveraging that background and those talents to provide advice and insights, ultimately working together to drive a better decision. That's ultimately the school board members, school board, and each member of the school board's responsibilities. Again, as distinguished from management. The day-to-day operations is for the administrative leaders. Thank you.
Joseph?
First of all, I would say they're kind of, it's like a wheel. They all have to work together, right? If one part is not working or supported, it's not going to go. So we have to work as a team. Everybody knows their role. Everybody knows their job. We have to listen to each other. I think everybody's already said this, so I'm probably just reiterating the same thing. But yeah, each role has a place, and we all have a place. But everybody has to do the work, or everybody has to be willing to try to do the work, right, to get to the end goal, because the end goal is to raise functioning young adults to get put out into the world, right? Mm-hmm. And if we don't do that, then we fail. And that's, we shouldn't even be thinking like that, right? So that's all I have.
Thank you. The response order for our next question will be Joseph Hart, followed by Stephen Cheddar, Kyle Christensen, Kelsey Jazerski, and Hannah Johnson. And our next question is, as a school board member, you would play a crucial role in shaping the educational environment for students. One contentious issue that has recently come up is banning or restricting certain books from school libraries or curriculum. How do you believe the school board should approach challenges related to the selection of books in schools? Joseph?
This is a good question. And I can use just something that I did the other day at one of the elementary schools. They were disposing properly of some books, and they had some books that were free to take, right? I found one was the Declaration of Independence in the giveaway pile, and the other one was a book from C.S. Lewis. Now, at the elementary level, I personally don't believe that those books would be beneficial. I'm thinking maybe those books would be more beneficial at like the middle school, right? Where the kids are starting to learn about government and kind of digging a little bit deeper into history. So I think we should be kind of looking at that and overseeing like what books are where, because books are very, very important to kids. But having the wrong books in the wrong places aren't going to help them at all. For example, myself, I hated to read unless it was something that piqued my interest, something sparked, right? So if we can find these right books to get these kids to want to read them, they're going to read them. But if we don't do that, then, again, it's poor management or whatever you want to call it.
Stephen?
So this certainly could be a very contentious issue, which the question laid out. And I think maybe the best procedure here is to start with common sense. If the book doesn't seem right or seem like it belongs in that place, there's probably something that's not appropriate about it. Obviously, each book needs to be age appropriate. You certainly wouldn't have high complexity or maybe divisive content in elementary school age books, but certainly at the high school level, that might be something where kids are learning to explore some of those contentious and maybe sometimes topics that are approaching on adult level content. And then maybe the biggest item, which certainly could present a lot of contention, would be the obscene content that some books do have, and the inappropriateness of those books being in a school format. Certainly, that book can be appropriately selected if the parent or the adult in that child's life feels that book is okay. But if that book is not an appropriate book for a school setting, then that might be the case. Thank you.
Kyle?
Sure, it is a great question. And I know it's been one that's been, you know, sparked a lot of interest recently, but the only thing I challenge in the context is that it's recent. I think book issues and selection of books in schools has been a decades-long issue. When I was a kid, I remember my community in up in arms because there was a group that wanted to ban a book called The Chocolate Wars. I read the book since then, and I understand that it's controversial in some context, but these are kind of issues that we've struggled with for a while more recently. I mean, I don't even think it's a partisan issue. A few years ago, there were efforts to remove To Kill a Mockingbird, Huck Finn, and books like Huck Finn from our classrooms. Even some efforts to replace Dr. Seuss books. There's probably not a greater author to advance literacy than Dr. Seuss, and seemed misplaced to want to try to remove that entire class of books. But for all that time on all those different instances. I think school boards and administrators and members of the community have worked together fairly productively to kind of solve those in ways that matter for them. Here in Minnesota, there's actually a new state statute that provides some structure around that. I think the legislature was looking to, it's sometimes referred as the book ban, but it's more about structure. In our school district, Policy 606 guides textbook and instructional selection and reconsideration. So from that standpoint, the role of the school board is this the right policy? Is it being used effectively? And is it, or does it require change? And if so, we work with stakeholders, including members of our community, to effect that change and make it a better policy. Thank you.
Kelsey?
Yeah. So first, I just want to say, I understand that safety is the reason behind wanting to restrict access to certain books. But I think what is considered safe differs from family to family. But I also want to say that I have faith in our media specialists and our administration to keep our learners safe and, away from the inappropriate things that they shouldn't have access to. I'm also quite confident that there are policies regarding what is and is not appropriate for both school libraries and the curriculum. So I trust that they're following these policies that have been set in place when deciding what to add to their book collection or curriculum. And as Kyle said, Minnesota has ironically banning books. And so, you take a look at these historical novels that are being banned based off of ideologies, but why aren't we asking what can we learn from these? What is there important to know? What's important to know from these books? They're important historically and for understanding and critical thinking. And books help kids figure out who they are during their adolescent years. They can help them feel validated and seen and confident and secure in their identity. So if we let this continue, where does it end? Thanks.
Hannah?
Sure, thank you. I am certainly no stranger to contentious topics. Kyle and I both ran for school board in the middle of a pandemic, a time when most people were asking us what were we thinking about getting involved. And I think for me, one of the things I'm most proud of is that for this or any topic that feels contentious to our community, the thing that's come most important to us is to purposefully model respect, integrity, and civil discourse. In a time when divisiveness feels ever present, anybody who's spoken to me knows that one of the things that I take most seriously as a board member is being a positive role model for our learners and communities and encouraging that there is more that unites us than divides us. So with that note, I'll also add that I think what's important as a board member is that I'm not here to push my own personal agenda or opinion. I'm here to represent my community. I'm here to be a listener. I'm here to understand what their vision is for their children, for their family, and to represent a broad perspective when I come to the board. There are six of us representing a district with about 41,000 people. And so we have a responsibility to be here and represent all. On this particular topic, Kyle touched on the legislative pieces. Kelsey touched on the trust in our educators to develop the curriculum and selections that are important. I will just say, I don't think that the school district, city, county, state, or federal entities should be telling families what their kids should have access to reading. I support that our school has a very effective policy for families being able to opt out and accommodate learning experiences for anything they think that their learner should not be a part of. We already have that process in place that happens on a regular basis upon request. And so any concern that a parent has about a particular book or a learning experience, our administration and staff are great at working with that family and making accommodations. Thank you.
Thank you. The response order for our next question will be Stephen Cheddar, followed by Kyle Christensen, Hannah Johnson, Joseph Hart, and Kelsey Jazerski. And the fourth question is, each time a tragic shooting occurs in our country, there are calls for increased safety measures in schools. What actions would you support be taken by the school board to increase safety in our schools? Stephen?
So I know the district has taken some actions previously to focus on entry to the schools. So generally all entries are locked but one during the coming and going, especially in the elementary schools. And likewise in the high schools, there's one or two options for the students to enter the building. And they're generally monitored as they're entering the building, at least at the high school level. At the high school level, we do have a school resource officer who's present there. It would be a potential option, should it be deemed necessary, to try to increase that level of support from the Farmington Police. And should, let's say, an increase in student bringing banned items into the building, perhaps consideration of other means to detect those items, screening processes, or perhaps even metal detection, which some schools in larger big cities do take advantage of. Thank you.
Kyle?
First, the premise of this is, you know, school shootings and violence in schools is horrific and completely unacceptable. There's a much larger conversation I think our broader society has to have around access to mental health services, enforcement of existing laws, and modifications that might make a difference at that level that's beyond the school board. In our schools, we implemented more physical security, that the type of changes or physical holds that Stephen mentioned, thanks to funds made in the 2015 capital levy. We had reviewed those as a board. The administration views those boards on a pretty annual basis. The reality is going much further than that would require a very substantial investment. Some area schools have actually done that, but it's not something that probably, you know, in terms of investments can be done by an individual school district, and certainly not, you know, if it's with state money, shouldn't be with like a matching funds scheme or something like that. I think we need to continue, the school boards need to continue to evaluate not just this kind of situation of like external threats to the schools. We also have to be mindful of violence within the schools. That's why I started out with violence in our schools is unacceptable all the time. Supporting mental health initiatives, including hiring and retention of staff. The telehealth services law will help that. Helping to reinforce a culture in our schools that respects life and respects fosters a healthy respect of differences of opinion. And also is very on top of understanding behaviors. We have done that in this district over the past 2 years. We've got an annual review of behavior issues and the discipline issue and the discipline that follows so that we can understand what's causing or what types of incidents are happening and what are the follow-ups from a policy. I'll come back to the board role. The board role is about policy. Are our disciplinary bullying and other prevention policies the right policies? Do they need strengthening? How do we move that forward? That's a great place to be.
Anna?
Thank you. And this is one of the hardest questions and conversations that I have with parents in our district and as a parent myself. As Kyle noted, this is a complex issue, and it's not just schools. It's grocery stores, movie theaters, concerts, parades. It's something that individual solutions will not address systemic issues as a country. And so it is a much larger conversation. That said, Kyle touched on the policies and procedures that we already have in place to review and promote safety on a regular basis as a board. If I would personally support any additional actions recommended by our administration, by our local law enforcement, these are the partners that we rely on to inform us about what the best and current way is to keep our schools safe for our kids. There's a follow-up to that about communicating with families and making sure that families understand the safety measures in place, that they understand the drills that kids are asked to do, that they understand the purpose behind the planning and the things that we do within the schools and buildings to be prepared, and to just know that we as board members are always here to talk about this, to hear, and to have conversations. It's definitely something that is ever present for us, and we are always open to hearing from the community to what they're listening to, learning, and would like to see us do.
Joseph?
Anytime I hear this, I get goosebumps, and I just get very irritated because it's usually always somebody who always targets an unarmed group of people. And it just, we could go on for hours on this. It just, it really, really hurts. I don't want to go extreme with anything, but sometimes I feel like within the schools, and that's all I can talk about on this, we can't control family dynamic or we can't control national things, kind of like Hannah said, but maybe we need to get to the point of structured discipline and consequences for these kids, knowing that you do something, here comes a consequence, and it's stronger than what we've used before. You know, maybe we need to build repetition there so these kids know they can't get away with things. Counseling is definitely something that's very important. The mental health issues, you know, and however they're tied in with electronics or personal family issues or what have, that's a whole other topic. I've even thought of placing retired military out in front of the front doors or walking through the schools dressed as a civilian, right? But just so that these people know that if they walk into these schools where these kids are, well, you can gamble, buddy. But do not take the lives of our kids, and know that there's going to be a consequence to your action, too. Thank you.
Kelsey?
Yeah, this is a topic that comes up every time one of these tragedies happens. I mean, we were just having this conversation last week, right? I work as a probation officer and case manager with juveniles who have committed a crime. And so I work closely with understanding what drove the choice to do what they did to break the law. But there's one common thing behind a lot of people's choices to do what they do, and it's trauma, experienced trauma, mental health. That's where we need to focus. That is what we need to treat and prioritize. We need to treat the trauma. And behind the criminogenic drivers, understanding what each individual needs are. Prayers aren't going to fix this. Being proactive will. So understanding what's the purpose behind the behavior. Having military standing at the front door is not going to help these kids. Support, understanding, empathy will.
Thank you. The response order for our next question is Kyle Christensen, followed by Stephen Cheddar, Hannah Johnson, Kelsey Jazerski, and Joseph Hart. And our next question is, as a school board member, how would you respond to parents' concerns about what is being taught in classrooms? Kyle?
Sure. This actually does come up occasionally. Not a lot, but occasionally. Friends or other acquaintances have reached out to me on occasion around this. And, you know, from a school board member, we talk back to what's the governance versus the management role. From a school board member, I always think about a big chunk of my responsibility in this level is to listen, to understand, and in some cases guide their navigation through the system. And in this case specifically, it always starts with a conversation and relationship with teachers. It's very important, I think, it's very important for parents to have a very strong and collaborative relationship with their teachers. I think we also need to welcome parents' involvement in their education. That's a leading indicator of success, of student success. So, and the, you know, how do we address, you know, parents' concerns on what's being taught in the classroom? I think it's just navigating the system for a conversation with the teacher. That's not getting us to either a resolution or an understanding. Talk to a principal. After that, there's members there's directors of education that work in the superintendent's office. Rarely would it probably come to a board level decision, but if it's egregious, it certainly probably could, and then it's gonna take on a different set of tones. But in this case, I think about the job of, you know, how do I respond to parents' concerns? It's helping them navigate the system in a way that's productive, focused on partnership, and leads to resolution. Thank you,
Stephen.
So I have some personal experience in this, in that a subject that was being taught in elementary schools was something I wasn't on board with. And I contacted the teacher and went in and personally screened the material myself, and I made a decision based on what I saw. So I think the key for me, at least, would be openness and transparency. I don't want to be surprised. I shouldn't be shocked by what's being taught. And giving the parents the opportunity to always be in constant or nearly continuous communication with their teachers in the classrooms. And giving those parents an opportunity to be welcome and engaged with that teaching process of their student and their children. Thank you.
Hannah?
As a school board member, one of the things that we recently initiated was a consistent annual stakeholder surveys from learners, families, and staff to give them regular opportunities to provide input in a way that helps the board make data-informed decisions on a broad level, responding to individual parent concerns. This is, Kyle really summed it up well in terms of our procedure and how we as school board members handle this when approached by parents. But I think, as he touched on, the most important thing is listening, understanding what the concern is, understanding the source of the information. A lot of times it's not from the teacher themselves. It's misinformation that they heard from someone else, and just starting with a conversation with the teacher is often enough times, as Stephen noted, to find a resolution for a family to address any concerns that they have. And so as a board member, continuously being up to date too on what we are teaching, it's very different from when I was a kid. Education has changed. It's come a long way. That was a big learning point for me when I came on, and just learning about what does education look like now? What are we teaching? What are the basics? Doing boardwalks through our schools to see our classrooms, visit with our teachers is an important part of the work that we do, and also making ourselves available and responsive to parent concerns when we are contacted about those is something that we do regularly and I take seriously. Thanks.
Kelsey?
Yeah, I mean, again, going closer to the end, I think everybody over here has touched on a lot of things, but I agree that listening first and foremost is important. I also think that curiosity is important, and then also helping them navigate who they need to talk to in order to, if they want to actualize change, who do they need to speak with. But I do know that the Department of Education, they specify like what topics are taught in schools, like what is required, what is mandated, and what information is disseminated. And I know that teachers are more than willing to sit down with parents and talk with them about the information that's being taught in their class. They're open to questions and feedback and collaboration. I mean, they understand the importance of the parent role in the educational journey. I think that as board members, we have the opportunity and the ability to advocate for what our community is asking for. I don't think that, you know, sitting idly by and doing nothing is gonna help anything, but I think that being a champion for our community and our learners is important.
And Joseph?
Just reiterating what everybody else said, the first thing I would do is listen. You know, Kyle's touched that, Hannah touched on that, Kelsey touched on that. And after we listen and empathize or figure out what answer they're looking for, then use the chain of command or get them the information that they need, right, to reach out to the correct place to get the question answered. Then I would follow up with the parent and make sure they receive that information just to complete everything, right? Communication's key, transparency is key, and clarity is very important.
Thank you. The response order for our next question will be Kelsey Jazerski, followed by Kyle Christensen, Joseph Hart, Hannah Johnson, and Stephen Cheddar. And our next question is, as a school board member, what is your role in supporting a diverse, equitable, and inclusive environment in our public schools? Kelsey?
Yeah, well, I mean, this is, so I ran 2 years ago, and this was actually one of my, a piece of my platform. Equity and diversity is important to recognize within any school, but I think especially here in Farmington right now. Our population of diverse learners is rapidly growing. I mean, we're up to, I think it's like 30% now. And we don't have anyone on the school board currently that represents that population. And when we don't have people sitting in a space where decisions are being made on behalf of these learners, it's not equitable. There's one set of perspectives from a singular kind of cultural idea. My life experiences are going to differ from everyone else's or non-marginalized community experiences. And my experiences as a marginalized person is going to differ from other marginalized people. But there's an understanding that we experience things and see things differently. We also need to celebrate and listen to our diverse students. We need to hire proactively teachers and educators that represent our population. It needs to be prioritized.
Kyle?
Sure. It's our job to provide, ensure, and support, you know, that environment, diverse, equitable, and inclusive for all students. I agree, our demographics, we actually learned about this a little bit more in detail a couple weeks ago in the Joint City Council and School Board meeting. As Kelsey noted, the demographics of this district are shifting pretty dramatically. I've seen it in my elementary school where my wife works. It's awesome. It's actually funny, a couple of years ago, someone, my son asked why the Christmas lights were up so early. It was in October, and I just kind of like, I didn't realize there was Christmas lights up. Well, it's Diwali, and there's a lot of Indian families in our adjacent neighborhood. It's actually really great. I think the role of the school board member in this is to continue to foster, make sure we're listening to all of our community members, providing opportunities for inclusive feedback, digesting that, providing opportunities for input, and also supporting generally the creation of a school and a school board culture, an administrative culture, and a school culture that support. Again, I'll reiterate what I said in another answer: respect for life, respect for diverse points of view, to respect for other opinions, and then to, I think I'll use Hannah's words, model the civility and respect in the way that we conduct our business, always driving towards the best answer, and always enabling or facilitating individuals to express themselves as part of the community. So thank you.
Joseph?
Well, looking at that, you can tell that young kids, the education system, elementary kids, for example, they don't care what race they are, they just want to be friends, right? They're there to learn, they just want to play with their buddies and have a good time. I remember the statistics, it was a little, I think it was over 70% in our district. I think it was Caucasian, and the rest were 34% were minority-based or what have you. There's a lot of growth that can happen with that. There's a lot of, kids can start learning things from other kids that maybe they have never known, or maybe they can be hanging out together, working together on a problem or something, talking about backgrounds. And we want to talk about inclusiveness. Everybody in our district has the equal opportunity to learn. It doesn't matter who they are. I think Kelsey touched on this, getting teachers, I don't know how to politely use the term, teachers of color, what have you, to try to get the kids to empathize or see that, and maybe they can learn a little differently, right? So, I mean, that's a tough question, but as long as we're all willing to work on that and see a goal again of getting, like, well-educated kids, that's all that matters. Thank you.
Hannah?
As a school board member, as others have already noted, the first thing that we have a responsibility to do is to listen. As Kelsey pointed out, we are a board currently of people of very similar backgrounds, experiences, and I think as a board member, being able to listen and then use our role to amplify the voices of the underserved in our community is one of the most important things we have to do. Second of all, working with them to co-create the solutions and strategies that we may identify as a school board and administrative team. Some of the examples include prioritizing dollars in the budget and securing things like the achievement and integration funds that Kyle mentioned so that we are using data to monitor disparities so that we understand what's happening as a system in our district and we're not expecting individual families to, again, have solutions that address systemic issues. We have a responsibility to monitor the data to understand what's happening, to prioritize dollars in our budget and make sure our staff and our educators and our teams have adequate resources to serve the unique needs of these learners and families, to dedicate dollars and strategies to identify, recruit, and retain educators of color, and to finally foster a community culture through that modeling that Kyle talked about, so that if we make an offer to an educator of color and they get on social media and see what's it like in the community of Farmington if I move my town here, it looks like a place they want to move, that they would be welcomed, that they would feel like they belong. Thank you.
Stephen?
So I think we should start with treating students as individuals. They deserve to be treated as such. The board's policy should be neutral. There shouldn't be any favoritism based on what you look like or where you came from. To be mindful that diversity of opinion matters too. And that all students have an opportunity, regardless of where they started or where they came from, who their parents are, or what they look like, and to not categorize kids based on that. Thank you.
The response order for our next question will be Hannah Johnson, followed by Kelsey Jazerski, Joseph Hart, Stephen Cheddar, and Kyle Christensen. And our next question is, how would you like to see mental health funding allocated locally? Anna?
Thank you for the question. I'm looking for the connection, as has previously been mentioned, to my role as a school board member and the serving the students and families of our district. Broadly speaking, mental health funding allocated locally and as a state, as a county, we're grossly under-resourced. As Kelsey highlighted in some of her earlier responses, we're grossly under-resourced in this area. Families and learners are waiting months to get in for mental health services. So in terms of allocation, we have to start with more and adequately funding them in order to increase access, to adequately meet the needs that have already been identified and serve the learners, which is my area of focus as a school board member, and their families so that they are getting what they need, especially when services are identified. I think the role that the school board plays in that in the district is often as an identifier. We have screening tools, we have well-educated staff and professionals who care deeply about our families and learners. And so additional funding for mental health resources in schools so that these professionals can continue to work closely with our students. They spend a lot of time with them every day. They are trusted individuals in many of our students' lives. They're oftentimes a go-to when they need a place, a safe place to talk and be themselves. And so starting with increasing funding locally, especially to school districts so that we can serve as a primary point of contact and entry into the system for students and families in need. Thank you.
Kelsey?
Thanks. Just mental health resources, we need everything. There are not enough mental health professionals to address the needs that people are asking us for. There are wait lists. I think the biggest need is clinicians of color. But for here in the district, I think continuing education on mental health for our educators, administrators, support staff, but more specifically, what trauma-informed care looks like, because there's already mental health aspects being implemented within the learning environment, looking at social-emotional learning, learning how to identify our feelings, learning how to empathize with others, learning how to create an inclusive environment. All of that is mental health-based. And so, if we are strengthening a holistic educational experience, we're going to be positively impacting the mental health aspect of our kids. And so I think there are a lot of things that we can do in district, but we can also be advocating for outside resources as well.
Joseph?
So this question is one that we could talk on, and I think we could talk on for like a week straight on this. It is very important to make sure that the kids are getting mental health in schools, right? If they need it, or talking with the counselor or a leader or anything like that. But the reason for the education system was to teach kids reading, writing, math, science, and then be able to do the arts, and then be able to do sports and all this stuff, right? The education system was based on that. Counselors and leaders should be there for kids when needed. Kids should have access to the mental health things, but also the schools need to work with the parents on that, right? First and foremost, the kids hopefully are getting this stuff at home. It's not the school's job to take care of the kid. It's the parents' job to take care of the kid with the school's support. Farmington should be working as a community on this. You know, for myself, if I see a neighbor kid down the road who's crying or doesn't feel well, or you can tell something's off, I'm gonna go make sure that kid's all right, right? So we hope people are doing that outside of the school as well. But like I said, it's important to have counselors and mental health things in our schools, but first and foremost, we need to stick with educating them and then letting mental health work as two parts with home and school. Thank you.
Stephen?
You know, it seems that a lot of communities have kind of lost touch with faith in their life. And for a lot of people, church or a faith community can be a safe place to go, that can be a place to have some tough conversations, or just to find a face that you can communicate with, and maybe a subject that's uncomfortable. And have mentors in your life maybe it's a coach, or maybe it's a teacher, maybe it's someone else through some kind of activity that you do on the side, to foster those connections with kids, make sure that kids feel welcome and feel valued, feel like they are important, and should it become necessary to give counselors the opportunity to communicate with kids and families as a team effort, and to maybe try to solve some of those tough questions that may be coming up in a kid's life. Thank you.
And Kyle?
So this is a tough question to answer directly, and I think we've seen a range of answers to it, and they're all very good, thoughtful responses. I think one thing is important to understand, if it's about mental health funding, mental health funding, as Hannah noted, is limited, but the other factor of that is it's also restricted. There's not a lot of things a school board or a school board member can say about how the funding is allocated. It has to be allocated the way the state says it needs to be allocated. The only other exception to that is if you try to go out for levy for specific mental health supports, but in this district in particular, we're having a hard time funding basic needs. So then what's the answer? The answer for that is, I've talked to Dakota County Commissioner Mike Slavik about some of this over the past year. And one thing he talks about, particularly with big complex challenges like this, is the importance of getting together varied stakeholders, that mental health funding and mental health resources are spread across cities, counties, the state, private enterprise, and school systems. So how do you organize that? How do you create opportunities for those organizations to get together and be a force multiplier? To take the same limited amount of funding and actually just get more value out of it and do more good for the people who need the help and the support. If the question is about how to allocate it locally, the sad truth is it's tough to say we could allocate it differently, but I agree with many of the sentiments here tonight. I think I think back to that conversation around how do we get other organizations to work more closely together. Particularly to solve really complicated challenges for populations that need some help. Thank you.
Thank you. The response order for our next question is Stephen Cheddar, followed by Joseph Hart, Hannah Johnson, Kyle Christensen, and Kelsey Jazerski. And our next question is, would you consider holding a forum with high school students to allow them to express their concerns and questions to the school board surrounding their educational preparedness in a rapidly changing world?
You know, it's always nice to hear a kid's perspective and hear what's important to them. I've got a couple of kids in my life. One is a nephew, and one is the son of a friend, who both knew that leaving school, they weren't going to go to college. They wanted to pursue a trade. And we don't give our kids a lot of opportunities to explore trades as a valuable job, but I would wager to say that probably a good portion of our kids that are graduating are not going to a college because they'd rather work with their hands, they'd rather own a business, they'd rather own a bit, say a barbershop, or they'd rather do something that allows them to be outside and beyond a college experience. And give the kids a chance to say, hey, I'd like to experience this. Why can't I get this opportunity while I'm still in school? Thank you.
Joseph?
My answer, yes, I would. It's always good to get firsthand feedback from somebody, you know, who is graduating. Yes, these kids are still in their teens, and we might have to go through a bunch of feedback papers to actually get credible ones, but reading them all and hearing what they have to say and just reading it and seeing, it could help us down the road adapt and change in the areas that we need to. Kind of like what Steve said, if there's not enough blue-collar work out there, or if these kids are getting called a certain way, or there's mental health with this, but if we're figuring out that these kids just need to work with their hands, or these kids just need to stand up during the day and have a different style of a class, well then, us as a district, we would be able to adapt to that. And the whole point of this is, like I said before, and I'm gonna keep saying it all night, is we're trying to raise the next generation of people that are gonna be in the world and actually be able to contribute. One day we're gonna be retired and have to be living off the system. So we hope that we can create kids, right, that can feed into that and help grow and then nurture, right, the next generation, the next generation.
Hannah?
I absolutely would consider it, and not only consider it, but are actually already working towards it. It's something that Kyle and I, our first year on the board, as we were kind of mapping out the things that we already do with stakeholders, including learners, families, parents, community members, we had a big spreadsheet going of, you know, what are we currently doing? What are the ways by which we, as a district, are offering the people who we need to hear from regularly something beyond give us a call or email us. And so in addition to the annual surveys for learners, we are planning listening sessions in the building. And I think probably the most effective thing that I found is just going where the students are and being engaged in the activities that they are. So trying to be present at the community events, trying to be on site at buildings and build relationships with students too, because they are the reason that we're all here. They're the people that we're making decisions for every day. Their voice absolutely matters. And the two student school board members that we have as a part of our board have significantly shaped and impacted the policies that we've developed. They've brought really important ideas, thoughts, feedback, concerns from students to us as a board. And so continuing to do that, keep building on that, is definitely something that I'll keep working on in another term. Thanks.
Thank you. Kyle?
Same answer, resounding yes. Definitely would consider holding a forum with high school students, and not just about this topic, but just about any other topic that's of importance to them. Agree that this was, on the community engagement first year, I mean, we were taking a look at how we could continue to foster more a more responsive school board generally. So it wasn't just about students, but yeah, I mean, I think it's important for students to take a look at how the school system is working for them and help us find answers that help them long-term. I would also add, you know, we've got, yeah, I agree. I mean, we'd hold a listening session at the high school. I think I'd want to coordinate that with the student council. There's also existing opportunities if they want to come in. There's listening sessions after the board work session, the first Tuesday of every month. They can work with the district office to ensure that there's a couple people there. What's that?
Oh, Monday.
Yeah. Coming up on Monday. Last Monday.
Oh, yeah.
In any case. There are all those opportunities. I really invite our students to take advantage of that. You see me at a football game or a volleyball game or anything else, grab my elbow. I'm happy to talk to students and try to hear what's on their ear. But this is important. I agree that there's a tectonic shift taking place, whether kids are going to college or trade school or something else. It's important. It's partially what their desires are, but it's also the fact that college is just an entirely different thing than it was in 1991 when I went. The value, the cost, everything else is out of control, and so they're looking at other choices. But yeah, I totally welcome it. Thank you.
And Kelsey?
Yeah. I mean, I think just a resounding yes overall, right? But I think in order to be able to engage in these types of conversations, we need to create a sense of safety first. I think that it's important that if we are having these conversations, we're inviting all voices to the table. And so I know that there are going to be learners that might not feel safe or confident in being able to speak their mind or voice their opinion in a room full of people that might not be able to understand where they're coming from. I think it could go even further, and we could break it down by different demographics. We could have a group of all girls. We could have a group of, learners of color. We could have a group of those who might identify as neurospicy. We might have, and so I think it's important to get perspectives from different populations of students, because every student is unique. They're all going to have unique experiences, but to be able to, encourage that honest and open feedback and discussion, that safety and trust needs to be established first. We need to build that rapport with them.
Thank you. And I think now that'll bring us to closing statements. Candidates will have 2 minutes for their closing statements, and they'll be in reverse alphabetical order, beginning with Stephen Cheddar, and then Hannah Johnson, Kelsey Jazerski, Joseph Hart, and Kyle Christensen. Stephen?
Well, I'd like to thank you again for the opportunity to be here. I appreciate the chance to have a discussion and to answer some of these questions from the public. I'm going to start again with focusing on student success. I mean, let's face it, if the students weren't in the system, there would be no purpose of us being here. And their success is the goal of hopefully every mom and dad, and most students aspire to be something of their dreams and something fantastic for their future. To make sure that knowledge that they practice, they get the chance to master, and that outcome that they get judged by is something that they're proud about and look back on fondly when they do finally leave school. And parents are a key to that success, to give them an important role. They are the most important adults in their kids' lives, and to make sure that we remember that. To give that both the kids, the staff, the teachers, a safe building where they're welcomed and they're happy to be in. And they spend a lot of time in that building, whether it's at lunch, gym, recess, some science class, maybe English, something in between, and give them the opportunity to be successful in all those different adventures they take through school. And lastly, to remember that the taxpayers are giving us their money that they've earned, and that it's our job to use it wisely, and to respect the fact that it's someone else's income that we've taken from them through taxes, and to do so in a prudent and wise manner. Thank you, and I hope I've earned your vote.
Hannah?
Thank you again to the League of Women Voters for hosting us tonight, and to my fellow candidates for coming this evening, as well as just being willing to run. It's a big commitment to serve your community, to be willing to serve on the school board. It's an important responsibility, and one that I have really been proud to be a part of the last 4 years. I'm a fiscally responsible, forward-thinking collaborator, and I humbly ask for your vote this November so that I may continue the work of supporting our learners, families, staff, and community for another term. I believe that if we change the beginning of a story, we change the whole story, and that education plays a key role in every child's story. As a creative problem solver with a strong work ethic, I would appreciate your vote to continue putting these skills to work for our district. My goals are to keep building momentum in the focus areas we've talked about, many of them tonight. Fostering a first-rate education that supports personalized learning, academic growth, and the social-emotional health of our students. Activating strategies that support recruitment and retention of high-quality educators and staff. Increasing district revenue and stabilizing school funding while minimizing the impact on taxpayers. Amplifying, diversifying the voices of community members, staff, families, and learners to better inform board decision-making. And strengthening district measures of success, communication, accountability, and transparency. I understand the crucial need for clear, consistent communication from our school district to help parents make informed decisions and continuously support their children in the best way possible as partners in learning. I will continue to be a strong advocate for all staff, learners, families, and taxpayers in our community. And I bring a unique combination of professional expertise in community engagement, strategic planning, quality improvement, and performance evaluation. I will continue evaluating progress, making meaningful changes, measuring impact, and improving outcomes, representing the vision of our community and families. Thank you.
Kelsey?
Thank you. Thanks again to the League of Women Voters of Dakota County for hosting this forum. Appreciate the time and the opportunity. I ran for school board 2 years ago, and I guess, as you can see, I didn't garner enough votes to fill one of those three seats that were up for re-election. Was I disappointed? Absolutely. I mean, who wouldn't be? But I am tenacious and passionate, and I don't give up easily. And these are things that I'll bring with me if I'm elected. We need a board member who represents our growing diverse population, our diverse learners, and we need new blood. My experience, training, and education as a mental health therapist can bring a new perspective in how to approach things and a different lens. Trauma-informed care is leading right now in how to respond to the different needs of these kids and our educators as well, to be honest. My position as a probation officer and case manager for adolescents means that I'm skilled at identifying, assessing, and responding to different risks and issues. I work well under pressure, and I'm an out-of-the-box thinker. I do believe in cultivating learners who are curious, collaborative, capable, and confident. I want to empower a holistic education that looks at the whole learner and not just if they can read, write, and do math problems. I want to prioritize the learners. I want to prioritize the educators and those that are molding our kids on a day-to-day basis. I want to work towards a sustainable future, one that's fiscally sustainable and just educationally sustainable. And so I hope that what I've shared tonight is enough information to have confidence that I am A-okay to vote for.
Joseph?
Thank you again to the League of Women Voters, City Hall, and everybody else here who came to attend tonight. If elected, I'll stand behind the words like I've said tonight. I'm going to stand behind balancing the budget, allocating funding accordingly when available. I didn't get to say this before, so I'll say it now in my closing statement. I own a small business. I do specialized auto body, so I know what it takes to balance a budget. I know when years are lean, when you have extra funding, how to save things, where to put it, where to place it, and kind of put the building blocks or the puzzle pieces together to see the end goal, all right? Secondly, I would really like to see consequences to actions with structure and discipline in school. When we can build that foundational value, kids will thrive. They won't have to worry about not being safe like we've heard a lot tonight. They won't have to worry about that. They'll be there for the main reason, which is learning, right? Being kind, building friendships, and like I've said again, building young kids to get out into that workforce and just kill it, right? And have a great time. I'd also like to try to find a way to raise these test scores, and I don't know the answer of that right now. I will have to dig into that and see, like, why are some of these kids not testing so well, right, or so high? That'll be another big thing that, like, I'll dig into really deep. And as my background as a blue-collar worker, I don't have a formal four-year college education, right? I had to work right out of high school, went to a year of community college. 9/11 hit. I decided to run, go into plumbing, and then from plumbing I went into specialized auto body so I can... I've worked my way to the point where I am today, so I think I can bring a different perspective to the table, or so every kid does not think a four-year college degree is the only option that they have. The trades, working with the business owner and building up from there, you know, building some value to themselves just in a different way. It takes a whole community, Farmington, so who's ready to get to work? I am. Thank you.
And Kyle?
You've made it to about the 1 hour and 20 minute mark, so I will keep my marks, my final remarks brief. Thanks again for the League of Women Voters to hosting this session. I also would like to reiterate the gratitude for the other four candidates here with me tonight. It does take a lot of courage to file that $2 statement, but it does. It's a lot of work. The work you've done already and the work that's coming over the next 2 months to meet with people, engage, and actually win the vote. This is part of that, but there's a long road ahead of all of us. I'd like to also thank all the past and prior board members, current board members and past board members that over the past 4 years have either provided advice, inspiration, mentorship, warnings, anything else about kind of the road we're on. It's a collective bunch of work, and it's great to have those friends there along the way. As for the kind of the rest, I want to reiterate the importance of board members to be open and available. I've done that throughout my 4 years, particularly during the pandemic when folks were concerned about different mitigation strategies. I met with so many parent groups and so many different parents, heard their concerns both for and against different aspects to help them navigate the system, understand why decisions were made that way. It's an incredibly important function to be able to connect with individuals and help them understand what's going on. I ask your vote for another 4 years. I want to continue our work, the momentum we've built around academic excellence, advancing literacy and opportunities for all of our students, for supporting all of our students and their families. I want to help make sure that everyone continues to feel more heard and engaged in the process, as well as fiscal responsibility, ensuring not just adequate funding, but also efficient use of our resources, and continue the work to enhance performance across the board, as well as the transparency to decision-making. So thank you very much. Have a good evening.
Thank you, candidates. And that concludes our candidate forum. On behalf of the League of Women Voters of Dakota County, we extend our sincere gratitude to everyone who participated in tonight's forum. A special thank you goes to our candidates for their commitment to the democratic process and their willingness to serve their community. The League of Women Voters is dedicated to researching issues crucial to our members and the well-being of our communities. If you're interested in learning more about our work and discovering how you can make a difference, please visit us at lwvdakotacounty.org. For additional information about voting and candidates, please check out mnvotes.org and vote411.org. Thank you again for tuning in, and don't forget to vote by November 5th.